Second.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the December meeting of the Society. Tonight is a special occasion in that the meetings, the lecture at the meeting is being recorded and will go up on the web. So not only do I extend a very warm welcome to the attendants here, but also to those who will be viewing it in the future. Tonight's speaker is Stanislav Zamyatkin. Stan is no stranger to the Society. He has been involved with it since before 2012. He was part of an organizing committee for a very successful Festival of Flags in Dunleary. And he has done a number of other works and has publications between then and now. Tonight's lecture is on a symbol very dear to Irish people, namely the harp. So it is my great pleasure on behalf of the Society to welcome you to this evening's meeting, Stan. And we look forward to hearing your talk.
Thank you. I would have gone with welcome. My name is Sheldon Cooper, and welcome to Fun with Harps. So, I want to first of all thank Tom for recording this, Tony for inviting me, and the rest of GSI. And also use this opportunity to thank Dunleary Rathdown County Council for being very assistive and helpful all these years, and helping me actually this year to go to England and Georgia, two countries that both have essentially the same flag and have traditionally used the harp on their royal coat of arms. In the Georgian case, that being the Bagrationi family. This is essentially the sort of version 3 of my harp presentation. So the first one I gave in September in Georgia, in Tbilisi, and then just recently in Birmingham, or Brom, in England. So you're essentially getting the iPhone 7 of harps. Not Samsung, because that will just explode. As mentioned, the harp is an incredible historic symbol that is an inseparable part of Irish identity. And I guess it goes with pride that we say that it's the only emblem in the world that's a musical instrument. People do say Burundi, but they don't actually have a drum on their coat of arms. It is an emblem. Burundian drummers are amazing, but we're the only ones, so don't listen to people. I just want to have a little welcome, and you'll know by the music of what kind of welcome that is. Considered by many the composer of Ireland, although he wasn't actually a composer as such, but everyone needs a composer these days. He has many wonderful pieces, as I'm sure as you all know. Now, I guess we need to, in order to understand the symbol in the Irish context, we need to go back to where it came from. Now, the oldest harp that was discovered was in 1929, and it's about 4,500 years old. It was discovered in Ur, the ancient Sumer city. And Sumer, as you might know, is really the cradle of Western civilization. It's where most Western things that we know come from. And it's such a shame that so little, I find personally, has been studied and talked about, and how, I mean, in comparison to today, sort of the image you see of the Middle East and present day Iraq, that's where the what the Greeks called Mesopotamia, the land between two rivers, the Tigris and the Euphrates, and I just want to point out, first of all, so these two objects were discovered in this royal tomb in Ur. The first one, it's tiny. It's only about this big. So it has two sides. So one, as you can see, is peace, the peace panel, and the other side has the war panel. So they depict, well, one side, people just hanging around, and then the other, killing each other. So it's a bit like Tolstoy's book, you know, War and Peace. But so perhaps that is one of the oldest, if not the oldest, depiction of the harp in the world. There is some Egyptian, obviously, images which are sort of dated the same or older, but we'll forget about Egypt for now. And there were four lyres discovered. The ones you can see now are from the Mesopotamian section in the British Museum. You see the silver, the Queen's harp on the left, and the silver harp, I think, on the right. One was left with Iraq, thankfully, so they have one. It was damaged in the second Iraq war, and thankfully those idiots from ISIS haven't gotten to it now. People debate, so some people say that perhaps the harp came from Africa, because what's very interesting is, if you just look at this, I mean, I haven't mentioned, it says lyre, and I mentioned harp. They are different, but they're from the same family, so essentially they're the same. Today in Ethiopia, specifically in religious matters, you find the Ethiopian Orthodox Church playing with the same, essentially, harp. So you still have that kind of lyre or harp being used today. Sumer gave us many things. Probably the most important are writing, agriculture, and beer. Three things that Ireland's famous for, funny enough. Sumerians, obviously, polytheists, they had many gods, and one of them was Ninkasi, the Sumerian goddess of beer, who we all subconsciously worship at times, I find. Speaking of beer and speaking of harps, I find Guinness deserves to come at the beginning of the presentation, because it arguably has created this image of the harp. And when we say the harp is Irish, we made it Irish. It wasn't Irish originally, and today you can find the harp all around the world. You can find it being played in Venezuela, in Ethiopia, as I mentioned, all over the world. But it's Irish because when people look at the harp, they think of Ireland. And that's what makes a symbol, a national emblem. Just like you can find clovers all around the world, you can find green everywhere, but people seem to associate those things with Ireland. So by no means do we have a monopoly on the harp, but it's ours. Guinness has used, actually, it was founded, as you can all know from the glass, in 1759, but they've only actually used the harp since 1862. As you will see now, they did register a trademark it in 1876, and this is the official statement they have. So, as Guinness had trademarked the harp symbol in 1876, the Irish Free State government of 1922 had to turn the official government harp the other way to differentiate between the trademarked Guinness harp and the official state emblem. Now, that is complete rubbish, because as you will see, since 1603, the Irish harp has been officially, at least on the British Roll of Arms, dating from James I, it has faced to the right, and as you'll see later on, the earliest symbol, or the harp that we have to represent Ireland as such, is also left-facing. And so it's beyond me, because they even tell you this, and if you go and do a tour of the Dublin Castle, they actually tell you this fact, which is complete rubbish, what I find. Now, early on, I heard people mentioning, and before this as well, people debated about my image of the evolution of the Irish harp. Now, the reason I had it right-facing is because that's how you see the iconic evolutionary line going of man, you know, from monkeys, or earlier monkeys, but still monkeys. Now, so what's interesting is that in heraldry, traditionally, heraldic figures are left-facing. In heraldry, you call it the dexter side, because you read the shield as such, as if you're holding it. So even though dexter means right, it's when we look at it, it's on the left. So that's interesting. And just to go back to Sumeria, because a lot of our timekeeping comes from there. So we instinctively look more to the left, and I think it's called, in photography, it's called the triple something. But anyway, we naturally look kind of to the left, and this is why we read from left to right in the West, because originally, it's all connected with the idea of clockwise or sunwise, as was originally thought of. Because if we're in the northern hemisphere and we look straight at the sun, it goes from east to west, so it goes into what we see as a clockwise direction. And moonwise is anti-clockwise, and so this is why Arabs and other nations would write from right to left. It's all to do with the movements of objects in the sky. Now, in Ireland, the oldest examples we find of harps are, as you can see, you find them in Durrow. So the oldest dates roughly to the 9th century. We can't be sure. Some people date it to the 8th century. I've gone with the 9th century. Probably starting with Clonmacnoise, the ancient religious center, which is now more or less a ruin, but still incredibly beautiful, right on along the River Shannon. Castle Dermot is a great one as well, kind of unknown. There's actually two exact high crosses on either side of the church, and we do believe that there was a third one, because you have the pillar there, so we assume there was a sort of a trinity. Monster Boys, so if you're going up to Dundalk. And Durrow, that photograph was taken from outside when the high cross, now it's inside, just because, as you can tell, weathering does play a role in it. Now, the point I want to make is the depictions we see here, we assume that it's the biblical David, because, as you know, that he was associated with the harp and playing in it. There's a term that was coined by Robert Graves. You might know him as a World War I poet or a writer in mythology. Most famous book is probably The White Goddess. But he coined the term iconotropy. So it literally means image turning, and that's what it is. So he described a process that happens not only in religion, but just in anything iconographic, where an image goes from one environment to another, or from one group to another, and it either intentionally or accidentally changes. So, you know, a lot of historians believe that the King David image, at least, of playing the harp, comes from the Greek person Orpheus, who was associated with Apollo, who also, if you go to the Dublin Castle, you actually see a lovely, I think it's a mosaic or a carpet, probably a carpet from Gilly Bags. And you have Apollo playing the harp, and it's believed that he gave it to Orpheus. And this is mosaic dating from 149 AD, which was Greece, now Turkey. And you see Orpheus surrounded by animals. What I think is really interesting is that you continue on and you see the depictions. I think this particular image is from the Shrine of St. Patrick. You see it in the National History Museum here. But, and then you go on to the 1604, so this is the coin from James I. But it's sometimes described as a grotesque head. I would go maybe with a lion, but we're not too sure. But it could be a bird of some sort, so there is some kind of progression and evolution, as the my title suggests. Now, Giraldus Cabrensis, Gerald of Wales. You might know him. He came over with King John in 1185. King John is, if you don't know, the bad guy from Robin Hood. Mm-hmm. But yeah, he came along and he produced this book, Topography of Ireland. Quite a negative portrayal of Ireland. And it was definitely used for many years on for political and, you know, other reasons. But so you find it's I don't know if you've ever actually seen it, it's incredible. It is interesting when you look at it, and then you find these little odd drawings at the bottom in different parts of the page. So you have the harpists, and you do have, you know, negative images of, you know, supposedly Irish people. So you have Irish people interloping with goats and sheep and stuff like that, which I find is a bit rich coming from a Welshman. he does point out one thing. He says, listen, Irish people are essentially savages, but they can damn sure play a good harp. And he does mention how they're better than the Scots and the Welsh, which I haven't mentioned yet, but they deserve mention because the depictions we have David on the ancient crosses can also be found in Scotland and Wales, Celtic brothers. So in chapter 11 you have the incomparable skill of Irish in playing upon musical instruments. So that sort of kind of stayed on as well. Now the oldest depiction of the harp as an Irish symbol. I say Irish because I'll explain to you now. It's in the Finbirchen Armoil, so French roll of arms, so it's just essentially a book listing a lot of roll of arms. 1270 is an interesting period in history of heraldry. There's people have different understandings of and the debate about when heraldry actually developed, and you know, there was rudimentary forms before that, but in the 13th century you find already heraldry really getting established. So by 1270 you already have the proper terminology, which you can find up there, so it's sort of a type of French, you might say. Le roi de l'Ant d'Azur à la Harpe d'Or. So he's essentially describing, he's saying, there's the King of Ireland, and he has a golden harp with silver strings, on blue. Now, as you can see, nothing's really changed. This is our coat of arms today. Now, the problem is, there was no King of Ireland. As such, then, we had the Lordship of Ireland, and as you'll see in the next slide, they used a different symbol. Now, the reason why I depict the Westminster Psalter, it's actually the oldest Psalter the Westminster used today. They have an image of King David, and it's actually wonderfully illustrated Psalter, but this particular image really stands out because of its sort of similarity, you might say. And up the top you find the original, the oldest essentially depiction of St. Patrick. It's now kept in university, I think, in California, but I'll get on to what is the original Irish color, but as you can tell, it is definitely blue. Now, the time of Richard III was short-lived, and a bit complicated, as you can see, at least in the terms of providing image an emblem from Ireland. So the Roos Roll, not sure, 1483. I think on the eighth page you find illustration of him with his family up to the left, which I cut out. But on either side you see the dominions illustrated, and this is what we call a crest in heraldry, so the thing over the helmet. And you can see, obviously, it's Ireland and a harp. Now, this is actually not mentioned that much in books, but it's worth mentioning that he brought in coins as soon as his brother died, Edward something. he brought a coinage which was continued on by the Tudors then after the War of the Roses that actually killed him. This particular, the three harps, anyone maybe has been to Sweden might have seen this image, because that's the main emblem of Sweden since really, I think, the 12th century. But they all, in at least the English case, they go back to, say, Edmund, who's the sort of the original patron saint of England, who actually stepped foot, unlike George, you know. The English people like to say, St. Patrick, he's from Britain. And you're like, yeah, but at least he stepped foot in our land, you know, unlike Andrew and George. But, one particular thing as well I want to point out, I don't know if you've noticed, very similar to the flag of Munster, and that's because it is boy. You'll see, I'll mention Leinster in a bit, and that too came from sort of a, so you have essentially a national emblem becoming a provincial emblem. Now, this is the oldest depiction of the harp as a proper Irish symbol. Symbolism in Ireland is always reflective of politics, and the reason why Henry depicted the harp on this half-crown coin is because of his claim to Ireland and his wish to take more of it. If you know, he only called himself king, and he created the Kingdom of Ireland in 1541, so a bit later. So this is sort of a pre kind of, I'm the king. As you can see, it's a what we call a Guinness harp, so it's right facing. You have a letter H there on the left, and a letter A for Anne Boleyn. 1534. This is what I love: all these things are combined in that particular year. So you have the first act of supremacy. So where Henry says, "I'm the king of the church," whoop de doo da, and as you know, in the Irish case, Silken Thomas, so that's the Geraldines, the last attempt, you know, to clinch the power. Anne Boleyn is, she's a funny one, because she's actually really, I find, the one that got Henry to, you know, tell the Pope to bugger off and sort of, create his own church and get divorced. Poor thing lost her head 2 years later, so I don't know if it was worth it, but that continued on, and then you see it with Mary and Philip as well. And what's interesting from that coin in 1534 is it goes through forms, and by no means do they just disappear. They exist, but just on different planes, so that kind of becomes more important. And then this is, as you can see, so it goes through form. And as you can tell, the anthropomorphic harp here is the winged maiden, or as we like to call it, the Maid of Erin. Now, there's an Italian painting from 1619 which depicts the harper playing a harp with a woman placed on, just like as you see there. Now, what I have here is really my theory of where I think the winged maiden came from, particularly as a figurehead from ships. Now, figureheads have always really been on boats. Vikings had different animals, but it's the depiction of a person that arises in the 1600s. I don't know, it's a natural conclusion that I would personally come to. The oldest Maid of Erin in the Irish context we have is in the map in Pacata Hibernia, so it's a book on the Nine Years' War, more or less subjective, I think it's on the second page, the map of Ireland, and you have the coat of arms. The silver mark you see here, that was used up until 2002. From 1730, in Ireland, we used for silver and gold and stuff, image of Hibernia, which is still used today. So it's quite a fascinating history and how it's gone. Now, the Irish green harp flag is today mainly associated with Leinster, but historically it began out as an emblem of Ireland, at least a hoped for emblem. An important point to make is that many national flags originate as naval flags. So you have the Russian tricolor becoming used as merchant ships in 1705. You have the original Union Jack, so without St. Patrick, in 1606, using the sea. The Spanish flag, 1785 as well, naval. So and this is why you can it's perfectly okay to say Union Jack, because that's what it is. And it's still a royal flag. It's not a, citizens were only allowed to use it from 1915 on land, specifically. And the Union Jack actually has different forms, depending if it's on land or it's on sea, in the sea. Now, the reason I bring that up is because the earliest documented use of the green harp flag we have with Owen Roe O'Neill. So if you all know him, nephew of Hugh O'Neill. Now, Owen Roe O'Neill, he went to Spain, he moved up as a soldier in Spain, then he came back for the Confederate Wars in Ireland. And as his ship, St. Francis, was docked in Dunkirk, in France, he was said to have flown this green harp flag. Now, as you may know, the Irish Catholic, the Confederation, was based in Kilkenny, so it represented Leinster without the Pale. And they used a lot of flags, but surprisingly, they didn't actually use any harps. Where they did use the harp was on the on their seal, and that's quite interesting. And because you see later on, there is a one example of some Irish student in Paris, I think, in 1647, who draws a sort of more or less the four provincial, essentially a coat of arms that's quartered and has the provincial emblems in each quarter, but the oldest representation of Leinster as a golden harp on green, and we know it's green by this, because in heraldry, if you don't have colours, this is the direction you draw in order to show people that it's green. You find this on a quite nice map, and you actually see up there, they do honour Charles II, as you do. And then you have the ancient kingdom of Meath. So and then you have other descriptions as well. And this is what is amazing is when studying symbolism, so in heraldry and vexillology, we need maps, we need armorials, we need things like this, because this is where they were depicted. Back in those days, there weren't actual proper books on flags. I mean, with time, around this time, in the 17th century, you already had flag charts, but they weren't as we would see them today. Now, I have skipped a couple of things. I've skipped the use of the green ensign, so the green harp flag, with first of all, before the Union, of the English flag, and then the Union Jack later. Now, it's one of those... it's an example of a flag that didn't really exist. It was illustrated in books and mentioned, but it didn't really get used. We have found some actual physical flags, and I'm speaking about the green British ensign with the harp. but it was really seldom used. And just like the what you see if we when you go on Wikipedia or you Google online, the Kingdom of Ireland, you have the what we would now see as the presidential standard. That pretty much didn't get used. You do see it in funeral depictions. So you see what we have at the, I guess it's time to show you some actual physical flags. This is an actual presidential one, which this is what they actually use. I have connections, so I managed to get one. But so you. There you go. Mm-hmm. Oh no. Confuse all these screens. So essentially, this, as it's depicted, the Kingdom of Ireland did not really exist. You have the odd examples of, as I mentioned, in funerals, so Queen Elizabeth I. So so when her funeral's been illustrated, so you have people walking with banners of her dominions. There's no depiction of it, but there is mention, written mention of the funeral of Cromwell, beloved in Ireland. So really, as well, an example of a flag that's associated with Ireland, but didn't really get used much. But now, speeding up to the the Romantic period. The period where most, I would say, European identities really originate from. We all know about the Irish Volunteers, founded in 1778 to protect Ireland. After the beginning of the War of Independence in America in 1776, a lot of soldiers were sent over to fight, so different groups were set up, volunteer groups, and now they progressed from using, there was some few examples of use of green, and then it kind of it became much more widespread. But in terms of seals, they pretty much always use the Maid of Erin, obviously with a British crown. Was a few examples of when the crown was not present for specific reasons, but that really led to the Society of the United Irishmen, and why they're so important is it was really them that established the harp, it really became associated with Ireland by a lot of people. Before that, it was an important symbol, but it wasn't really taken to heart as such. And that's really a product of the history of politics, politicization, sort of the ability of people to take part in society. The United Irishmen adopted a wonderful motto, it's new, strong, and shall be heard. And that's something that you see in literature and poetry later on, so the use of the harp and the strings for, in, maybe in the British case, in terms of control, and in the Irish case, more of sort of freedom, independence. And it was, it's difficult to say, This is the birth of something. You know, flags and emblems are not people. They don't have a birthday to go by. But if we do give them a birthday, I would give the green color and the green harp flag 1798, the Irish Rebellion. So that's when it really established itself. And it's very much a product of the time, the French Revolution, of everything really. This is just a few examples of, there are many, many examples. You can probably see very kind of a rare case of of the Irish tricolor there in the middle, the carpet weavers. They were noted to have used this, so not the proper tricolor, so not the one that Thomas Francis Meagher brought over from Paris in 1848, but really the sort of something that goes back to this, what I mentioned earlier, this the 1790s essentially, because the Orange Order was founded in 1795, and since then it really, its history was always, it went in parallel to the Green, to the nationalistic movement, so it was sort of tit for tat a lot of the time. And what's really interesting, you have also the, I think was Drennan in his poem where he first mentions the concept of Green Isle, sorry, the Emerald Isle. But going back to the use of a variation of the green flag in the 19th century, probably the earliest one, 1803, so right after the Act of Union, so Robert Emmet's attempt to bring that back, bring back legislative independence. And then you see really the harp and the green color being promoted McConnell's movements, so that really did play a part. I mean, he really acted out. He, as you know, he made a show. So when he came out, he put on a show for everyone. St. Patrick's Battalion is from the war they fought with Mexico, where I mean, the states that complain about Mexican immigrants coming in was actually Mexico before. Funny enough, Battle of Ridgeway was a bunch of Irishmen's attempt at creating an Irish Republic. Instead, they created the Confederation of Canada the next year. So, good luck, guys. And then the Dublin municipal flag, which is, people think it is, it represents, because Dublin is the capital of Leinster, as such, it represents Leinster, but it's not. And there's a history to that, which I won't get into. That involves Trinity students, so...
Enough said.
Now, going to the 20th century, the harp was very much a sort of a tool. It was, as the anthem mentions, as... I guess poetry of Thomas Moore. You have this idea of the green harp flag and how it's an inseparable part of Ireland, and as if it always existed. And I guess the point I want to make here is that as we've seen with the centenary of the First World War now, as we've gone through. All the different battles, and this year specifically the Easter Rising, there's definitely a dichotomy and divide. And as you can see up there, there's the British posters, so trying to promote Irishmen to go and fight. I quite like who can beat this plucky four. I don't know. I like it because plucky. I don't know. I think of the harp in that case. And then you have. Rescue of the Nuns, with what looks like presidential standard,
yeah.
But it was coloured in the wrong way, I think. And then you see John Redmond, and there's the Dublin National Shelf, actually. Now the thing is, the reason why I'm showing this, these are images, they're on display at the National Museum in Collins Barracks.
Yeah.
And you can see there, this is the flag received by Michael D, a president, from the Enniskillen Museum in Enniskillen, County Fermanagh, in Northern Ireland. And so this is the particular one. It's incredibly basic, but it's incredibly beautiful if you manage to see it in real life. I guess this year marks not only the centenary of the East Rising, but also the centenary of when the green harp flag stopped representing Ireland on a wider scale, because it was the actions of the men during the Easter Rising, and it was the tricolour, not the Irish Republic flag, that really won people over, because people saw it as a revolution flag. I mean, it's the French tricolour, and so it's the fact that the green harp flag in 1916 represented everyone, and because the Irish tricolour represented the few, and they thought, well, we can have a clean start, and so that's why since then we use the tricolour rather than the green harp flag. Now, the thing is, sports is important in any country, and I think it's even more important in Ireland. So these are the actual official flags of Dublin. This is the Dublin Municipal flag, and this is the actual Leinster flag. But despite a few examples in the city centre in Dublin and other places, you don't actually find them flying that often. You do find this. Leinster flags been flown at games, people's cars, stickers, and so on. And then obviously in the GAA sports, Gaelic football and hurling. And that by no means is just one flag. There's so many variations, because in Ireland we don't have actual county flags. But we do have our de facto county colours that act as flags. There's no standardization, and so it's really left to people's imagination what to do with it. Now, when the Irish Football Association was founded in 1880, they used a harp. Today, unfortunately, since partition of Ireland in 1921, they set up two football associations, and today, unfortunately, neither one uses a harp. But you can see blue in that. And what's interesting is that they originally they played in blue, so not green. So obviously today we see both teams playing green, but originally they played in blue. I think we all know that the cricket team, the grass hockey, I've shown the ice hockey, the grass hockey and the rugby are played on an all-island basis, so they have people from both sides of the border or the sea. But they mainly depict a shamrock, essentially, so they don't use a harp. And not a lot of people know, but we have a baseball team that can carry baseball inside the harp, a baseball bat, I'd say. But anyway, surprisingly, in the Gaelic sports, you don't actually have the harp being used that often. Now, the only two counties that use the harp are actually in the north, Armagh and Down. This is the old Kerry one. I brought a flag in, I'll show you later. That's sort of like an uber-Irish thing going on there, I find. Leinster, that's the group sort of logo that they use for them. And so the Bridge Harps, the two clubs. But really, apart from that, I have not found any other uses of the harp in Gaelic sports. Now, the reason I show Armagh, because Armagh has traditionally been depicted with the harp, the only one actually on the island. For anyone who might not know, Armagh is the ecclesiastical capital of Ireland. And if you go up to St. Patrick's Cathedral, so this is the Church of Ireland one, and that's where you find Brian Boru's burial place, who also was associated with the harp. So this is the Armagh coat of arms, which is not actually used anymore because of what they did in Britain with the counties and stuff like that, so the arms essentially became obsolete. But it does come from a charter that was given to the city by James I, and the harp was depicted on it. But today, in Armagh, you actually find quite a lot. Well, the £5 note is one of the notes you find in Northern Ireland. They actually depict six counties, the arms, the traditional arms of the counties. You have a high school showing the harp, you have the rugby club, you have the GA club, you have the cricket club, football club, even the Orange Lodge banner has a maid of Erin, and then the Lord Mayor, who, as far as I know, still holds on to the actual official arms. So today, really, it's Kildare Council. Now, I show two things, because the right is the actual coat of arms, and to the left is the logo. Mm-hmm. So Kildare is the only one that would depict a harp in Ireland officially. As you can see, Armagh, this is the logo they use now, completely different, big blob. Mm-hmm. Londonderry, you can look up on the flag of London, that's what we see, so English flag with a sword is the flag of London, and you see the Maid of Erin there. Tralee and Leixlip don't really exist anymore, that became part of Kildare, and that became part of Kerry. Funny enough, that looks sort of like a Guinness logo, obviously facing the left, but the reason I also mention Guinness is because Leixlip was where Arthur Guinness originally set up his brewery in 1755. Mm-hmm. Funny enough, so when you have your pint and you look at 1759, that's the year he moved from Leixlip to St. James's Gate, which is actually the same road, Galway Road. I can't confirm it, but I assume that the right-facing harp on their arms is Arthur Guinness. The rose is some English bloke lived there, so I don't know. And obviously the salmon, because Leixlip comes from the Norse, Laxlap meaning salmon leap. So, and then they have the Viking ship and then the Gaelic motto, so it's very much a product of Irish history there, put into one. Now, Trinity College, I will speak highly of this because I am a student there still, so a little bit of bias. Trinity College harp has been in Trinity since really the end of the 18th century. It's had some adventures. We can say that. So people date it to the 15th century. We're not really sure. It could be the end of the 14th century, so 1300s. It's on display at the old library. It used to be kind of there in the corner, which I didn't really like. So now they kind of put it behind the stairs in the long room, and it's much more central, like roundabout sort of thing. So I'm happy about that. Brian Brew is associated with the harp because, like in any country, Ireland's not short of myth making. So you have this myth that Brian's Brew's son made a pilgrimage to the Vatican and he left the harp there. And then just before Henry told the Pope to bugger off in 1534. The Pope was meant to have given the harp as a present to King Henry VIII, and sort of that kind of made it its way here. But that's not really true because we know it dates to the 15th century. There was a lot of adventures. I guess it was when it came to the hands of Trinity originally, it was in a bad state. They tried to fix it. Did a bad job. It actually ended up going up to the British Museum in 1961, and then being fixed up, and that's what we see. It was actually robbed by some IRA man in 1969. He was trying to rob the Book of Kells, but surprisingly, security there was better. So he just pinched the harp, came back. Don't worry. Now, this is the going back to the Irish Free State. As you can see, is clearly no standardization of the Irish harp. And you, as you'll see, that kind of continues, even though standardization is brought in. Yeah, see, this is one depiction on a passport. I couldn't date it, so that's why I have nothing there. And this is the Irish Free State seal, which became the seal of the president. You can actually see that real seal in the museum in Collins Barracks and show. And every if it's not a Queen Victoria postbox, then you get a Irish Free State search that Aaron. So yeah, stationery envelope, rubber stamp, so a lot of variation. Beautiful, but not standardized. And 1928 is when the first Irish coinage was brought in. 1927 is when they had the competition, and an Englishman by the name of Percy Metcalfe, he's actually done some designs over in England as well, on medals and stuff. So he actually designed the harp, and that's it sort of stayed there. So he created the Barnyard collection. And if you go back to what I mentioned about iconoclasm and the depiction of the harp along with different animals, so you had the harp on the other side of the coin and you have the animal. So I for me personally, that's a continuation of the past there. I've shown this because I find it's amazing the fact that it's pretty much the same time. The last depiction of the winged maiden on, as you can see, so you have the actual British, yeah, so one side is plain harp and then the other is made of Erin. Yeah, so the 1937 is when the Irish tricolour was written into Article 7. So that kind of essentially standardized it and protected it. But, the harp was not mentioned because there was no real emblem, at least official one. Now, in some ways, in a normal Irish fashion, we instead of having adopting a national coat of arms, we adopted the presidential standard first, and then a national coat of arms. So the designs are different. We can see they're pretty much the same. It's essentially a golden harp on a blue background, as we saw. Essentially the same image that's shown in the Finnbjörken Armorial. But yeah, so 1938, because of the new constitution, the strings were changed, were lowered, and obviously error was written into the seal of the president, who I guess only really took his proper place in 1949 when Ireland became a republic. But we won't argue about that. So today, this is how, you know, we would, on a day-to-day, well, day-to-day, I don't know if we all pay taxes every day, but at least we see these. So these are just normal examples of how we would see the harp. And probably not notice it, you know, there's a lot of harps everywhere we don't see. Now, in politics. So... I find most people don't know this, but there's actually a winged maiden just on the gates of the Parliament, Rochtus. So next time you're walking by or you're protesting or whatever you're doing, you can have a look at that. I mentioned earlier about blue. Now, blue is the original colour of Ireland. Green is the official. We haven't made it official, it's just official. But the blue is very much part of Ireland, and you see it in the carpet, in the Dáil, in the Seanad. You see it at St. Patrick's Hall, the original carpet in Ros an Uachtaráin, presidential house, that was blue, and I got a green one. So yeah, very much. Now into what I guess the harp is not alone, and neither is Ireland to the sort of the movement of logoism. Has creeped in into governments and essentially everything. Essentially, everything has become a business. Everyone is trying to sell something, and everyone's trying to create a mark for themselves, a logo. What happens is, since the 1990s, you've had this incredible just diversification of the Harp. So even though they're same country, same government, different departments, yet they all use different emblems. Now, personally, I love them. I just don't think they belong on departmental symbolism, because to me that suggests that they're different. They don't belong to the same government. They're someone else. I love the agriculture one. That's wonderful. Like, but that belongs in a museum or a gallery, not a government offices. Now, I'm only showing a couple. There's plenty of examples. And as you might know, not all of them depict the Harp. So these are a couple more. So that looks like a pizza slice, obviously. Cost, understandable why they don't have the strings, because it's dealing with domestic abuse. You can see someone, I don't know, it's either a Greek column or someone's bowing to the court. So, yeah, it's up to interpretation. Now, I've shown this. This is what Britain. Yeah, I know. They have a department for exiting the European Union. Like, who the hell is that? Only this is post Brexit.
One way out.
Yeah, exactly. But Brexit means Brexit. I use this example because this is how I would like to see our Harp used in government news. Yeah, okay, it's maybe mundane, it's plain, but it's stylized, it's ordered, and you know who it is. You don't have to think about it straight away. And it really is black and white. This is just to compare. So this is the Ministère des Affaires Sociales et de la Santé, the social affairs and health. And you have Unrowan Slauncher. And as you can see, not only is the building, but the logo, which does not depict the Harp. Yeah, so, we got our tricolor from France, so I think we can get a lot of other things from them as well. Now, sticking with health, so these are a couple more examples. So any ambulance you see going around through Dublin, they would have this emblem. Telehospital, office chief, that was granted quite recently at a national maternity hospital. I'm guessing a lot of people were born in. They depict the Harp at the top. Okay, that's enough of that. Education, so now at the bottom you see two examples, because one is a logo, the other one's the actual arms that were granted to them, because that's what happens in Hellinger. It's posh, they're granted, they're not just given. But you get a diploma, as you probably know, in UCD, so they would show that. In Trinity, they would actually use this. You probably know why, because originally when it was founded by Queen Elizabeth I in 1592, they wanted to copy Cambridge and Oxford and have a couple of colleges in the university. Never went around to that. Just have the one Trinity College in University of Dublin. As you can tell by the name, the Royal College, so that's why they have a royal crown. And then you can see the top as well, the Maid of Erin is off the top. You actually have banners hanging off from the buildings as well. And then there's a few other examples. There's the Independent College, just beside Trinity as well, then the National University of Ireland, funny enough, they use one as well. And then the national, they give out the diplomas and stuff like that. And the Irish Harp Centre, I mean, I understand, obviously, they have to depict a harp, but don't show a woman spying on her neighbours, like, peeking through the curtains. Because that's what I see, you know? Anyway, and then we get to the defence forces, you see. That's actually, the civil defence. And the Irish Coast Guard, it's not actually in the Department of Defence, but I've shown it anyway. Here's another example of their own sort of a harp man with a spear. That's what I see. The emblem. Yeah.
Anchor.
Well, the anchor, the coast guard. Quite beautiful. I mean, that's actually quite old. I think that dates back to the 19th century. So, great emblem. I think they can use it because they're not actually part of the government as such, I think. But anyway, yeah, it's up to interpretation. Yeah, the navy. Examples of royal, you can tell, the crown, the National Yacht Club, and the naval service. Naval Jack, actually, is that's what actually looks like. The way I remember it is, I just think of Elvis and his hair. That's how you know that's the shape of the harp. Most images you find online are actually wrong. And there is one or two photographs, so you know that's the proper one. So that Naval Jack is from 1947, so it's designed a year after the naval services were founded, just after the Second World War. So, something that happened during the Second World War was we found our own. It was always based, and since the Irish Free State, it was always based in Dublin Castle, but they decided to divide it up in 1943 because of the death of the Herald, and so that got incorporated with Norway. So that's the original one. That's what we had. So they designed the arms of Tipperary and Carlo and stuff, and a lot of other ones. And that's the one that we use just to complicate things. So the section in GSI that deals with heraldry, we call it Heraldry Ireland, and the section that deals with flags, we call it Vexillology Ireland, because we're all about simplification. So the top three you see is the peerage of Ireland, so the Duke of Grafton Street, you know, Earl of Caledon. You can see these arms in Dublin Castle, so if you take a visit up there. And there's, I would say, a few examples of family arms that would show the harp. And this is, one last one, really, to show sort of the other examples of the harp. So the Ryanair, I guess some people say it, Guinness and Ryanair are the two main symbols of Irish capitalism. So this is the Francophone. The reason why the strings are a different color, because it comes from the Francophone flag. So when the Alliance Française organizes their month of French, they use that. So. Quite intuitive, I think. But yeah, Irish Independent, Ireland's main selling newspaper. RDS again, Royal, see the Maid of Erin, and then the Posh Club in Stephen's Green. And then Roots Ireland, you probably know. Just to end, really, that as you can see, we've seen throughout history in Ireland, diversification of the harp emblem that really has only increased. I found that the changes, that you might, I might use the term iconoclasm, the changes to the harp at different times have always been reflective of the changes in Irish politics, in Irish culture, in Irish society. And so we can't say what the future holds, but we can say that in one form or another, we will still find the harp. And ladies and gentlemen, I've shown you the aesthetical side of the harp and its symbolism throughout Irish history. The thing with symbols is that they're more intuitive, the more you deal more with the feeling side. And so in order to understand symbols, you need to experience them and live them. And so I just want you to remember that we're all made of Erin.